Now, hi dear students, in today's episode of Dimes Medicine Unplugged, I will look at a CT scan with you and this is a patient with abdominal pain and we don't have much history available to us in the radiology referral form, and we'll try to look at a CT just like we would do in a actual hospital and how we would do it in our radiology department. I'll try to give you an idea, and in between we'll keep discussing why and how of it and what has happened in this patient. So whenever we see a CT of the abdomen in a patient with abdominal pain, we always start by looking at the scout film. Let me zoom it for you. So when you see the scout film now, you can see at the bottom there is some localized dilatation of the bowel loop here, and plus we can see that this is the transverse colon. The transverse colon appears gas filled, and after that you don't see any gas in the descending colon. This is what we see on a plain film. There's no abnormal calcification, there's no calculus that is visible here, which is again a point that we should always note on a plain film. And the bones, the vertebra, the iliac plates, they all look fairly okay on a scout film, which we should be looking at. And it's always a good idea to look at the lung basis on a scout film also. You feel that the CP angles are not well defined here, but we'll try to confirm the diagnosis when we look at the actual CT here. So let's look at the contrast enhanced images now. So this is a contrast enhanced CT abdomen. You can see we are again starting from the lung base, because when we start from the lung base, then we take sections from above below. So in this section, you can easily see that what we were suspecting, there is actually bilateral pleural effusion. You can see there is bilateral pleural effusion in this patient, and we could see that even in a scout film. And that is where I always tell the residents to, don't ignore looking at the scout films, because that gives you an idea that what we are going to look at. And it is like in the olden times where people would always do a X-ray first and then do a CT, while in a modern radiology department, most of the time in a abdomen, we would directly go to a CT. But it's always a good idea to look at it. It gives you a good insight into the pathology. But let's find out. Okay, so I'm now scrolling the images for you. Okay, so you can see. So you can see now in this section, you can see the liver, the stomach, and the spleen. And there's pleural effusion still, and I'm going down. Okay. Now I want you to look at the image in front of you now, which is going to tell you how to look at the abnormality here. So when I now zoom the image for you, you can see this is your pancreas. This pancreas is bulkier than usual. This pancreas looks enlarged, but this is not a focal enlargement. There's a diffuse enlargement of the pancreas. And if I actually take you below, this enlargement, this heterogeneity is continuing till the head and uncinate process also. And I also want you to appreciate here, do you see there is streakiness? This streakiness is inflammatory stranding that you see in the peripancreatic area. Do you see it here? Do you see that there is streakiness in the entire peripancreatic area? Again, telling you that we are looking at something inflammatory. Because if you are dealing with an acute inflammatory process, there will be edema, there will be swelling, there will be inflammation. So you can see there is stranding of the peripancreatic fat and diffuse enlargement of the pancreas. But I want you to notice, although this pancreas is diffusely enlarged, appears slightly hypodense, but there is no non-enhancing area. We don't see any non-enhancing area. And that is of value, which we'll, when we are looking at, we are thinking of acute pancreatitis. And acute pancreatitis has been classified into a milder form, which is the interstitial pancreatitis, and a severe form, which is called as the necrotizing pancreatitis. Necrosis would be seen as non-enhancing area. So here we don't have any non-enhancing area. And I also want you to notice, when I'm scrolling back and forth in this area, you can see there is this area. There is thickening of the Girota's fascia. So you can see there is thickening of the Girota's fascia. And if you now compare the fat that we saw in the peripancreatic area in the anterior pararenal space and the fat that we see in the perinephric space, this fat around the kidney is preserved. And this is what is called in pancreatitis as the renal halo sign. This is what is called as the renal halo sign. So there is thickening of the Girota's fascia as well. And if we again look at the contrast images by scrolling back and forth, you can see there is some, a little bit of fluid collection also here. So in patient with pancreatitis, we'll call it acute peripancreatic collection here. And this is very important to notice that the terminology here is that in a patient with acute interstitial or edematous pancreatitis like this, where we see this here, in initial stages, we'll call it as acute peripancreatic collection. But if you see a well-walled off fluid collection in this patient after 4 weeks, we will call it pseudocyst. We will not use the term pseudocyst in necrotizing pancreatitis. For necrotizing pancreatitis, the term to be used will be acute necrotic collection, and we will call it walled off necrosis after 4 weeks. So we don't use pseudocyst as a term in necrotizing pancreatitis. And to see necrosis, we need contrast. That is why we are doing a contrast enhanced imaging here, because we know that the necrosis can only be commented upon when we are looking at a contrast enhanced image. And also keep in mind, radiology is not essential to make a diagnosis of pancreatitis. Now, when do we think of pancreatitis clinically? Is when you have a severe epigastric pain, you have elevation of amylase, lipase level more than 3 times, and you have a radiological on CT or MR or ultrasound evidence of pancreatitis. But out of these three, any two are positive, you will make a clinical diagnosis of pancreatitis. So keep it in mind that CT that we are doing right now has more value it is useful in diagnosis, but only when we are not able to make it clinically otherwise. The CT has more value in looking at the severity of the disease. And that is where, we need to look for necrosis, where we are looking at non-enhancement. But if you do a CT too early in a patient with pancreatitis, it may, underestimate or overestimate, it may not be able to correctly estimate the amount of necrosis. So it is usually recommended that you should not be doing a CT in the first 72 hours for prognosticating or for severity. Many places they do a CT even after a week to look for necrosis. So, at least after 72 hours, you should be doing a CT, not before that. And this is in the CT when we were looking at, we could also see that the gallbladder has some hyperdense content. You can notice it. It looks like there is some sludge here. You never know, there could be some calculi also. And sometimes CT scan misses out on gallbladder calculi. So it is a good idea to look at this patient with ultrasound for gallstones. Why ultrasound for gallstones? Because we know that gallstones is one of the most important etiologies behind pancreatitis. So as a radiologist, we also comment on the etiology. For example, one of the classic etiology here would be gallstones that we would always keep in mind. But there could be other causes of pancreatitis like alcoholism, which we would have in the history sometimes. If it is written there, it gives us a good correlation. There could be ductal abnormalities like pancreatic dewisa. And sometimes if we see a sausage-shaped enlargement of the pancreas, and if the standing is not the kind that we are seeing here, if there is some preservation of a halo around the pancreas, then you would call it as sausage-shaped pancreas. If you see sausage-shaped pancreas, then you think of autoimmune causes or IgG4 related disease also. So pancreatitis could be autoimmune as well. So this is how we actually do it in a radiology department. I'll again trace the anatomy for you. But let's go back and think about it. Why did we see that there was air in the transverse colon, and we saw it on the scout film? I'll show you something. I want you to look at the descending colon where my arrow is. Okay. So this descending colon is having spasm. So in patients with acute pancreatitis, descending colon develops spasm. So after the transverse colon, you get at the level of splenic flexure, you get a cutoff. So on a plain film, that is called as the colon cutoff sign. That's called as a colon cutoff sign that we saw on the plain X-ray. And you can see that this focal dilatation of the small bowel loops that you see here is called as the sentinel loop sign. We saw that on the plain X-ray also. So plain X-ray can, with the X-ray findings of pancreatitis, you can have a gasless abdomen, you can have a colon cutoff sign, a sentinel loop sign that we see in this patient. And this is where, we could correlate the X-ray finding with the CT finding. So I hope, with this discussion, you get an idea. And pleural effusions, ascites can be associated with pancreatitis. We saw pleural effusion in this patient with the association. And today, when you talk about severity of pancreatitis, we also look for presence of pleural effusion, and we also look for presence of ascites. We look for presence of vascular complications also. We look for any pseudoaneurysm formation or any portal vein thrombosis, which is not there in this patient, but we always look for those complications on a CT scan. And this is what is expected from a radiology resident also, because I see this is one of the very important cases that we will give to a radiology resident when he is appearing for the exam. And we will, this is one of the very characteristic case to be given to him to understand and, you know, explain the findings and the role of radiology here. And MRI has a role, especially in, you know, in the necrotizing type of pancreatitis, to look for, you know, necrotizing collection or walled off necrosis. There MRI has a role to play. That is again an important thing to remember for your viva voce as a resident as well. And I want you to, you know, see the anatomy and how it actually feels like in a radiology department, how the fluid collection is seen here. You can see this is the acute peripancreatic collection that I was talking about. So, you know, you can actually see and understand the concept behind things. My suggestion to you here, all the candidates who understand that I am trying here to give you the overview. It would not matter if you are a final year student in MBBS or a resident. If you understand the anatomy, if you understand what is happening, you will be able to do better in the exam. So I want, so that is why, if you notice, I have labeled this as, you know, this discussion as conceptual radiology. And this is the series that we have started in DAMS. There are a lot of videos under the hashtag DAMS Medicine Unplugged. If you, you know, go through them, you would actually learn how to approach the patient, how to approach the case. And that is our goal in this series. I wish that you enjoy the series, and do write in the comment section if you have any more doubts or any more clarifications here. I wish you all the best.